In our last episode, we talked about rain barrels to capture and store water for use in your garden. But one rain barrel only captures so much. What if I told you there's a practice that not only keeps more water out of the storm drain, but also cuts out the middleman and goes directly to a garden? Because it is a garden, a rain garden. Maybe you've heard of rain gardens. They are just what the name suggests, a cultivated area designed to hold rain runoff long enough for it to soak into the ground. Essentially, they're built by removing and shaping the soil into a bowl and adding native plants. Okay, there's a little more that goes into it than just that, but if you're thinking about building your own rain garden, it helps to see a few of them to get a better idea of what they are and how they function. This helps you decide what works best for your property. We're here with Amy Thorin, who recently bought this house that came with the rain garden, and Leslie Mitchell, an engineering technician with the City of Champaign. We're here to demystify this rain garden for Amy and for you, and to talk about the things that we need to do to take care of it properly. So step one is knowing where your water flows through your rain garden.
This rain garden has curb cuts, so it's allowing a lot of the street water to flow into the rain garden. The purpose then is all this storm water will come in through the curb cuts, and we will slow the water down, we'll hold the water, and we're gonna also infiltrate a lot of the pollution that's coming in off our city streets.
Step two is getting to know the plants in your rain garden.
So what is the difference between the plants that need to be in the water at the base and which plants kind of go in the drier areas?
So the irises, they can be in the lower areas. Some of the grasses that you see around the edges of your garden, and they're still gonna, they can handle some water, but they don't mind having their feet dried out or their root system dried out.
How do I know what I wanna keep in here and what I need to pull?
As you can see, we kept an area from the street to the rain garden. So in that area, I would just pull whatever you have growing. And the rest of this, these plants have done so well, they've shaded out all those weedy annuals that we all have problems with in our rain gardens, whether a rain garden or somebody's just typical garden. And you also want to check for trees. We have a lot of squirrels in the area that like to bury nuts. So you want to pull out your weedy, well, your trees that start up as little saplings.
Which plants in here are pollinating plants?
So during the different times of year, we're gonna have different things blooming. So right now, you'll see your New England asters, and I bet you see a lot of bees over there. So those are pollinators. In the summer, in June and July, your wild bergamot is gonna be blooming. And you're just finishing up with your mountain mint, so you would see things really blooming in here in July and August. And then in the springtime, we have Golden Alexander, and it's a bright, beautiful yellow flower that starts to bloom in May and June.
Step three is waiting for the rain to come so you can observe that the rain garden is working.
You're gonna wanna make sure that the rain garden drains within 48 hours. That's gonna prevent mosquito breeding.
A well-maintained rain garden goes a long way to reduce stormwater runoff while enhancing your landscaping and improving property values. Many cities offer financial assistance for property owners to install rain gardens. Contact your city to find out about opportunities in your area.